to start my recording because some people. So, recap quickly around how a database works. Remember, we've got a database in the sense that, like this thing, we've got a golf database. A golf database has got tables inside. Each of these tables has got related information in that. So you'll have a table for the players, all the different golfers you get, with their name, surname, manufacturer, and so forth. You'll have a table for your scores. So player 1 on hole number 1 got a score of 5. And player number 1 on hole number 2 got a score of 2. And then you'll have a table for your holes, which you've got your 18 holes with a par for each hole. So all of them are sort of related with the score 1. So the player 1, we can get his name from here. So that is Anne. So Annieville. So Annieville on hole number 1, which was a par of 4, scored a 5. So they sort of linked with this. So a database, recap, database could have lots of tables, and each of these tables are related with the database because it's a golf database, but each individual item is in its own table. So all the scores is in one table, all the holes is in one table, and all the players is in one table. So you've got all these different things grouped together. So you're going to see now when we start linking them with this, we can actually, like, that's why I put these three buttons here. So when you're going to click the golfer table, we'll see all the golfers. When we click hole, we'll see all the holes. When we click score, we'll see all the scores. So that's the idea behind it. Alright, so quick start with this thing. I put the wrong component here. So if all of you, I am recording this, so you can have a look at it afterwards again for the people that, and if you get load shedding in between, just know I will upload this to YouTube and to the Google Drive. I'll add it to the same golf program. So this ADO, it shouldn't actually be an ADO data set, so we can actually delete that one. We're not going to use this particular component. And then if we go to the components, there's one called the data source. We actually need a data source. Okay, so how these different ones work. So you'll see we've sort of got three different ones. You've got a connection.
In the program that you uploaded,
the components we've got here, we've got three different components. We've got our ADO connection, a data source, and three ADO tables. So they're sort of the same thing. Why there's three of them is just because we've got in our database, we've got three tables. So that's why I've got three tables there. Now, this connection, what the connection does, it creates a connection between our program or Delphi and the database itself. That's the purpose of this one. So let's start with that one. So the first part we're going to do, you're going to click on your ADO connection once you put the component down, and you're going to go to the connection string. You're just going to click there, then you're going to click your dot dot dot. Brings up this option for us. And then we say build. On the build one, you will always choose the JET4 option. Then you'll say next. So these ones are like for different types of databases. You'll see the Oracle database or SQL Server. So it's different database programs, or you remember our DBMS, database management software. So it depends on which one you use, you'll actually choose different ones from here. But for us, we're going to use JET4. Then we say next. And then in this part here, you'll actually go select your database. So this, if you do this, what I've just done now, you'll actually fix your previous one. That's where Sandir also got stuck. So you'll just have to create this link again. And then you click on the dot, 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 and then you go look for your database. So what I did mine was, is on my desktop. So I go to my desktop. I've got a folder for Delphi projects. I'm busy with DB exercise 1. And I need the golf DB. And then I say open. And then you say OK and OK. Now the connection string is done. The next part you do is, you'll see there's a login prompt. Just say false for that thing. Otherwise, it's going to ask you for like a username and password, and you'll just have to click OK the whole time. It's a bit irritating. So you just unclick that one. Okay, then we go to our ADO tables. So you can click on the one table. So the connection, we just do connection string, and you untick the login prompt. Then we're going to go to our ADO table 1. So ADO table 1, by connection. You will now just choose your ADO connection 1. Then you'll scroll down, right at the second two from bottom. You've got table name. And there you'll see your tables now. So let's say for table 1, we're going to choose the player. And then you can go right to the top and just say active. So for each of these ADO tables, there's three things you do. If I go to ADO table 2, step 1, your connection, you choose ADO connection. Step 2, you go to table name. You select the table name you want. In this case, I'm going to choose core. And then step 3, you just make it active. And then you do the same for table 3. Go to your connection, choose your ADO connection. Go down to the bottom, choose your table name, which is table hole. And then you'll just make it active. So quick recap, at your connection string, you click the dot dot dot, you choose JET4, and you select your database. Okay, outside, login prompt false. Then you go to your tables, choose your connection, choose the table name, and then make it active. And then we go to our next component, the data source 1. So your data set here, you can now choose which table do you want to start with. Like when the program runs initially, which table do we want to show first? So let's say table 1, so that we can see the players' names. That's what we choose there. And then you click on the DB grid itself. And then your data source will just be data source 1. And then you should already see your player names. Now, in this case, you'll see player ID and then first name is just very big. And the problem that happened there was, if we look at our database itself, if you go to our table player, we go to our design view. If you look at first name, the field size, they left as 255 characters. So what it does, it actually keeps that space then. So to make ours look better, if you look at all the names, there's no names that actually even more than 10 characters. So what we can do is, let's just change this then to 15. And I'm going to change my surname also to 15. My manufacturer, I'm going to change to 15. Handicaps number, that's fine. Join date, date and time is fine. Club reference is short text, so that I'll also change to 15, just because. Then I'm just going to save this, then I say yes. I can go back to this view. Remember, your database must always be in this view, in the data sheet view. If it's still in design view, you'll actually get an error in Delphi. Now you'll see, if you go back to Delphi, it's still like that, because that's the way it was initially. So what we can do is, with our connection, with our ADO table, we can just take the active off, make it active again, and then it refreshed. So now we can see nicely everything fit nice and good. We can maybe just go check, let's look at our score. Everything is number, so that's fine. We just go back there, in a table hole, everything is number, so we can just go back there. Okay, so now our connection is done. So this connection creates a link between Microsoft Access and Delphi. And then, and our specific database. Then these tables creates a link between this connection then and a specific table. This data source extracts the information from one of these three. And then the DB grid gets its information to display from the data source. So it's sort of all linked up. So it's actually, if you want to, like, you'll see when we play the program, don't worry about the components themselves, because as soon as you play it, see, the components are gone. You don't see those components, you just see the, so your connection is like the main connection. Then we will link our tables, our ADO tables, to the connection, and then the data source gets information from there, and then the grid gets its information from the data source itself. Okay, so everything up until here will be given to you. You don't need to do anything up until this step for tests or exams. Tests and exams will now ask you to do these specific buttons. So they are actually very straightforward, especially the first few. These three and these ones are very straightforward. These three are a bit more challenging, so I'll help you with them. With a goal for one, that just means for in the, what I want with this button, I want to, when it's clicked, to just display all the golfer's information, sort of like what it is now. Now, if you can remember, which component that we use to give information to the grid to be displayed?
Data source?
Yes. So when we go to this one, the only thing we do there is our data source one. Can you remember which property we used in the data source? In this data source, which property did we change?
The data set.
And then we just made it. Which table was for all the golfers' information? ADO table one. So the only thing you do there. So your data source one, the data set must just be ADO table one. That's literally all you do. So if we want to see the whole, we must just remember the whole one was ADO table 3 is our table whole. So for the whole one, our component data source 1, the data set must just be ADO table 3. And for the score, we must just remember ADO table 2 is the score table. So for score, our data source 1, the data set property must just be ADO table 2. Let's really test this. So if I click all, there's all information, score information, golfer information. There we've got all three tables all sorted out. Okay, what we want to do now with this one, if the first golfer button is clicked, it means that we just want, wherever this arrow is, irrespective where, we always want it to jump to the first golfer, and we just want to show his name, surname, and handicap in those edit boxes. Okay, so we double click on that. Now, firstly, we want to put our cursor, or we want to select the first one. Initially, it's always on the first one, but you don't know, like when we click next and previous, it will actually move on. So it might not be there, but when this one is clicked, we want it to move back to the first one. And we want to just extract those three values, the handicap, the surname, and the name. So it's actually relatively easy. Which component of these, all these components we've got here, works with the table itself, with table for the table for the golfers? Remember when I explained to you like what each of these components does? One of these components here has got the table's information inside them. Which one does that have?
For all the tables, it will be
connection. No, just one table.
Oh, ADO table 1.
So, everybody agree. ADO table 1 has got the information of TBL player inside him. So, we want to just in our ADO table 1, we want to go to the first record. By just saying ADO table 1.first, it goes to the first record in that table. Now, we just want to display in these edit boxes. I already renamed them as EDT first name, surname, and handicap. So we want to give them values. So I think that sort of self-explanatory, EDT first name. Which property do we use again for edit boxes?
Text.
Yeah, the text. So, and our EDT, I'm just going to do all of them. So EDT surname dot text, we want to give a value to, and our EDT handicap dot text, we want to give a value to, because we want to display in them. Now, in the first name, out of which component will we get the person's first name? Do you get it out of the table? Remember this, that your DB grid is just for display purposes. We don't actually extract from there. So which of these components has got the tables information again?
Table 1.
ADO table 1. So the first name we want to get from ADO table 1. But now we don't want all the information, we just want a specific field. So how that works is you're going to put your square brackets. And then you put single quotes. So inside the square brackets, inside the single quotes, we have to put the field name. Which field name do we want to extract for first name? The field that's called first name, do you agree?
Yeah.
But now you must just look at the spelling, but everything there looks fine, except there's no space between first and name. So that must also just be first name without the space. And that's literally all you do. So the surname we also get from ADO table 1. And which field has got the surname? Field that's called surname. So inside there we just say we want the surname field value. And then the handicap is in the handicap field. In the square brackets inside the quotes, and the handicap. Okay, let's quickly see if this works. So when we click this, there you go. First person is Anvil, handicap 7. So to answer some questions, you'll see the field names inside is inside quotes. So it's not case sensitive. If you wanted to put this all small letters and we play this thing, still works fine. So it's not case sensitive, but it must be spelled correctly. And unfortunately, because it's inside quotes, control space doesn't work. So it doesn't pick up which fields are there. So you have to actually just write out the field name exactly as it's spelled there. And as you can pick up with handicap, well, it's a string. It's a number inside here, but we could just display it immediately. Okay, let's look at the next one. So, for last golfer. Okay, so I'm lazy. So, we know we want to display all those things again. But now we don't want the first golfer, we want the last one. So which property do you think we're going to need? There's a property just called last. So now if you play, first golfer will be the first golfer's information. Last golfer, it will jump right down to the last one. And then to Tomcat. Handicap 7 as well. Okay, then if we take next golfer, which property do you think? If first was for first, the last was for last, if we want the next golfer, which property do you think we're going to need? Or which procedure will we call?
Next.
Dot next. And it's as easy as that. And then previous, which method do you think we'll call for previous?
Prior.
Okay, so Previous is the only one that's not too straightforward, but Prior, I don't think is too challenging. Prior is also for previous one, and that's it. So now we can quickly test this. So there's our first golfer, there's our last golfer. We can go previous and it goes back, or we can go next and it goes on. If you're on the last one and you say next, it just doesn't do anything. If you go previous, you can go previous until you're at the first one, and then previous doesn't work anymore. Alright, and that's just normal moving through and then displaying a specific value inside our components. Okay, so now we've only got these three buttons left. So for the add score, we just want to, whatever the score of the person is, let's quickly see. So on the score screen, so the add score, we just want to add a score to here. So we want to say which player on which hole at how many hits, or what was his score on that particular hole by that person. And the remove just wants to remove a specific one from these ones. Alright, so for our add score, so we just want to add one to the table itself. So how this works is, degree we want to insert. Remember each, what do we call each line again inside like a database? What do we call each of these lines? Okay, so each line is a record. We call these records. And each column we call fields. So I've got a field for whole number, and then I've got 18 records. So a record is for row, and a field is for column. So in this case we want to add a record, and we want to add it to our, so we just need to know into which table do we want to add the record. Then we want to add a score, so table 2 was for our scores. So what we do is we just say our ADO table 2 must just go into insert mode. So once you say ADO table 2.insert, now it sort of, the whole table is now in, like, I want to say edit mode, so that we can now actually add a record to it. But now for this we need to add 3 fields. Now let's just change this one, table 2, so we can remember this. So we've got a player ID, a whole number, and a score that we want to add to this thing. So in our add score button, so for our ADO table 2 we want to add a value into a specific field. So the first field we've got is player ID. So our ADO table 2, the player ID needs to get a value, and we'll do that now. But as with that, our ADO table 2, our whole number, one word, whole number needs to get a value, and our ADO table 2, score needs to get a value. Okay, everybody with me so far? I don't think it's too challenging. So quick recap, we want to add a new score, or add a new record, or a new line. So we put the table in insert mode, then we say the fields. So table 2's player ID needs a value, player 2's whole number needs a value, and player 2's score needs a value. Now it depends where you want to get the values from. We can get it from, do we want to do it with input boxes maybe, so that we can type in what we want? But if you got it from, let's say in this question there was components here where the user could type it in, or combo boxes or whatever, then you just put the component names there. Or if it was fixed values, you can just say player ID 2 with whole number 3, got a score of 5 or 4. So you can do that also. But maybe to make it look a bit better, let's do input box. Okay, so we want to do an input box for that. And then let's do it for all three of them with input boxes. But remember, don't leave them blank. I just did that so that I can type in. So this is for insert. So I'm going to put insert. This is for the player ID. Let's use the example player ID 2. This is also for the insert. This is for his whole number. It's also whole number 2. And then this is also the insert. This is for his score. Let's say he got a 2. Ah no, it's gonna look too funny. Let's put a 5. And once you've done all of that, we just need to have like a save. And the save part is, so our ADO table 2, we want to just post. What post does, post actually saves the information back to the database. So now it's saved. The only problem we've got here is after we've done that, the new stuff is now added. But our display will still be wrong. So we just need to reset our ADO table 2. So we just have to take our ADO table 2 and just close it. And then just take our ADO table 2 and just open it again. So just close it and open so we sort of reload the information from the database itself. Okay, let's see if this works. So we can now add a score. So let's say player ID 2 got the whole number 2 got a score of 5. Okay, then you'll see we got an error. And you'll see when you start reading this, they say the changes you requested to the table were not successful because you could not create duplicate values in the index or primary key. So on our database by table score, if we look, you'll see the primary key is the player ID and the whole number. Can you see there's two keys there? So those of you that studied for that theory test and can still remember a bit, when we've got two fields which are a primary key together, what do we call that again? Okay, so I just deleted the specific player 2, whole number 2. So now if we play this and I want to add a score, then I can use player 2, whole number 2, give it 5. And then you'll see if you just go down, there's our player 2 and whole number 2, got a score of 5. Then it could add it. Because it wasn't there yet. The error we got is because it clashed with our primary key. And remember, the main thing about the primary key is it must be unique. So you can't have duplicate values. But now we've got our, this. So you'll see if you do like I do and you just go back, you'll see the number 2 is not in here yet. You just have to close the score table and then just open it again. And then you'll see your number 2 is back. Player 2 on score 2, player 2 on hole 2 has got a score of 5. Okay, so I'll quickly jump to the change hole button. So with change hole is, let's just take this now to table 3. So let's say the course changed a bit and we want to, hole number 1 must now be a par 5 and not par 4 or whatever. So we want to change the par score of a particular hole number. So with a change hole, as you can see, change hole, remember when I changed that, was everything with ADO table 3. ADO table 3 has got all the information for the holes. So if I want to change a particular hole, who can help me? What do you think is the like one of the first things we need to do? Algorithm wise.
Get the ADO table looking.
Say again, get the ADO table.
That you want to extract from our search.
Okay, yeah, so we know now it's ADO table 3.
Yeah.
Okay, what else do we want to do? But forget about the coding wise. So, do you really want to change the specific goal? So step one would be, let's find out which hole to change. Do you agree?
Yeah.
So let's create a variable. And let's call it search. You can make it integer or string. Let's do it integers because our search is actually all numbers on numbers. So let's make it an integer. So step one, we'll just ask the user. Which hole does he want to change? So we'll get that from an input box, which is a string. So we need to change our string to an integer. And we do input box. So in the input box, this will be the change button. Which hole? Example hole number 2. And if we want to, we can do the other part as well. Let's say new part. Where we can then just ask the user what is the new par score he wants to give it. So we can ask the user which hole does he want to change. And then we can ask him also what is the new par score. So it's change. And what is new par score? The par score is 6, just so that you can see it easily. Okay, so step one, let's do the inputs. Let's ask user which hole does he want to change and what is the new par score. Now what we do there, do you agree the next thing we need to do is we need to go through this database. It's sort of, you have to think of our change that we did in arrays. So step one, ask the user what does he want to change. Step two with arrays, what was the next thing we do with arrays when we want to change something? I need you to talk with me, people. What? Yeah.
Wait, what was the question?
Okay, so let me pause. Okay, so with arrays, we used a for loop. Because we had a counter that told us how many elements were there in the array. But in this case, we don't know how many elements are there in this database necessarily. So the best way for us to do it is we want to actually use a while loop. And we want to carry on while we're not at the end of the database. Or end of the table, I mean. So while we are not of our ADO table 3, end of file, do begin. So while we're not at the end of the file of this ADO table 3, we want to carry on. Now remember I told you, whenever you use a condition in a while loop, you need to initialize beforehand and you need to change on the inside. So our initialization for this is, do you agree we want to start at the first record? Obviously, when we want to start looking for the one to change, we have to start looking at the first one. Maybe it's the first one we want to. So we want to start, how do we go to the first record again?
Dot first.
So now we're at the first record and we want to go through until we reach the end. So after we check now something, do you agree we want to go to the next record? So how do we go to the next record again?
Dot next.
Alright, so this is your core part for your for loop. For your while loop. You have to start at the first one. You want to carry while you're not at the end of the file. And you want to go to the next one. So please remember these three pieces. Even some of my grade 12s, still now when they presented their patch today, they forget this piece and then they get an infinite loop and then they don't know why is it an infinite loop. Because you're at the first record, you're checking if you're at the end and you never go to the next record. So you're at the first one infinite amount of times. So that's why you get infinite loop. So if you want to go to the first one, you want to stop at the end, you have to go to the next one. Otherwise you'll never get to the end. But then we do the same thing. Remember with our arrays? We got our input. Then we did our loop. Arrays we did for loop. In this case we do a while loop. And then we had our if to do our comparison. So we just want to see if the hole we're looking for, so if our search is equal to, and then that particular field, do you agree? We want to see if it's equal to the hole number value. So our ADO table 3, and the field value we want to look at is hole number. So if the hole number we're looking for is equal to that particular hole number, then our ADO table 3, the par field, must now just get the value of our new par. Okay, the only thing we need to also add to this, we need a begin, the end, unfortunately. Because just as when we added a new one, we had to put it in insert mode. We also have to when we want to change it. So once we found the one we want to change, our ADO table 3 must go into edit mode. Because now we don't want to add a new one, we want to just change a value. So table 3 needs to go into edit mode. And then we can go change it. Okay, let's quickly see if this works. Alright, so let's
So you spelled hole.
Oh, okay. Okay, but let's try. We're gonna get an error now. Let's quickly see the error. So I want to change hole number 2. Just got a par score of 4. So 2. I want to change to 6. And now I get an error. If we look at the error, can you see there, they say field hole number not found, because hole number doesn't exist. It's supposed to just be hole number. Okay, so let's click play again. Let's change hole. So hole number 2 must become 6. And then if you look there, hole number 2 is 6 now. And that's how we do our change.